written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since, in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. Let's pray. Holy God, in the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts, be acceptable in your sight.
God, whose love for us is without measure. That's the thing about the gospel. It seems to show up most loud and clear when we are facing each other in unfamiliarity and disagreement and distrust and discord and fear. In our reading this morning from 1 Corinthians, we get to eavesdrop on the Apostle Paul attempting to preach from a distance to a divided congregation. And he wants them, as we read last week, to be united in the same mind and in the same purpose, which we know can be easier said than done. And eventually, in this letter, as we read on, Paul addresses some of the specific things that they find themselves arguing about, which is the same kind of stuff church folks have been arguing about forever. Food and sex and how to settle conflict and marriage and payroll and how to get along with people different than you. Same fights, different blame. But before he gets into specifics, Paul wants to start back at square one. Before we talk about all the ways that we are each jockeying for position in these fights and disagreements, we need to take a look at the thing that put us all in the room together in the first place. Paul says, "My job, first and foremost, is to proclaim the gospel." And he writes this: "For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Now, Paul sees the church in Corinth not getting along, not seeing things all the same way, not being unified, and Paul may be disappointed by this, but he is not surprised. The territory surrounding the gospel, specifically the territory surrounding the cross, has never been without conflict. Some see this message as foolishness and others as wisdom. Some see it as weakness and others as strength. It is as though everyone hearing this message, some view it as fact and others view it as alternative fact. How can this message be so true and invaluable for some and so untrue and worthless for others? But unapologetically, Paul seems to say, I know that it seems crazy, but what we proclaim is Christ crucified. That's what we've got. And yes, we have the God with us, Christ of Christmas, and the resurrected Christ of Easter, but if we're going to talk about unity, the part of the story that we cannot overlook is this Christ in the middle. Christ crucified. It is a stumbling block for those who want something concrete. It is foolishness for those who want something that makes sense. But nonetheless, we proclaim Christ crucified. This is our gospel. Now, Christ crucified should have meant the end of a movement rather than a beginning. That's what the Roman Empire wanted it to mean. That's what some of the religious leaders of the day wanted it to mean. They wanted to put a stop to what they saw happening all around Jesus. This uprising, this resistance that they feared could evolve into a people's revolution. To be crucified, to be executed in the way that Jesus was, meant something. It wasn't just the way criminals were punished then. It was the way a particular brand of criminals was punished. This was the way they punished those of particularly low status. Like the very, very poor. Like slaves. Like the folks most likely to grow displeased with their station in life, and rightfully so. Those that an empire might want to put down and keep down so as to squash any rumblings of rebellion. Crucifixion was also the punishment of choice for those who were viewed as They should have had to resign themselves to the fact that such foolishness and weakness are not the makings of a revolution. A couple of years ago, Pope Francis got himself into a little trouble. If popes can actually be in trouble, I mean, who yells at the Pope, right? But he got some bad press anyway for a sermon that he preached at St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York, in which he was talking about the way we evaluate our work as faithful people. And in the sermon, he said this: "The cross shows us a different way of measuring success. Ours is to plant the seeds. God sees to the fruits of our labors. And if at times our efforts and work seem to fail and not produce fruit, we need to remember that we are followers of Jesus Christ, and his life, humanly speaking, ended in failure. The failure of the cross." Pope Francis had a lot of grief for saying that, but I think he's got a point. From the outside looking in, the message of Christ crucified doesn't sound like good news, because if that were really the end of it, it wouldn't be. The gospel is Christ crucified and Christ resurrected. The gospel is the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. The gospel is, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. But the reason that we must not gloss over the message of Christ crucified, this message that can look like foolishness and failure, is because it shows exactly what God is capable of. Christ crucified leaves no room for us to say, no, 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 my situation is too far gone. I am too lost. I am so not enough that there is no way that God will ever be able to love me or put me to good use. Friends, the message of the cross is one of complete disaster and unmitigated failure. And yet, from this humiliating death, God brought forth life. Not just for Christ, but for us. And not just for us, but for the whole world. The God who brings forth light from darkness, the God who creates from the dust. This God needs no more raw material than complete disaster and unmitigated failure to bring forth life over and over and over again. Paul goes on to write to the church in Corinth: "Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in this world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord." Jesus always chose first the ones who were used to being chosen last. When he lived on this earth, he hung out with tax collectors and sinners and prostitutes and the mentally ill and low-wage workers, and the disabled, and women who didn't feel worthy or valued in the least. And today, Jesus is with trans people and young incarcerated black men. Jesus is with poor kids in underfunded schools who are treated as though they have no potential. Jesus is with women who feel the safety of their bodies threatened every single day. Jesus is with shell-shocked refugees from war-torn countries. And Jesus is with Dream Act teenagers. Jesus is with scared families who sit in airport detention rooms wondering if they will ever be able to rest in a place that feels like home. Christ Crucified is a story for those who are up against the wall. Christ Crucified is a story about failure for an audience of losers. Christ Crucified is a gospel for those of us who do not have it all together. And now, this narrative might not resonate with you personally. Your experience may be one of success, one of advantage and privilege, one in which you have only enjoyed the fruits of hard work, unencumbered by the burdens of discrimination or unfavorable circumstances. Which is all the more reason, friends, that this gospel is also for you. For you, all the more, it is a means of purpose. It is a call to action. It is an invitation to return the grace you've been given by way of what the Lord requires, to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with God. And to speak boldly for those whom Jesus loves. To feed the hungry, to care for the sick, and to welcome the stranger. Because the fact remains, Christ Crucified is a gospel that lifts up those against whom the deck is stacked. God chooses the weak and low and despised in this world, the people of this world who are looked upon as nothing, as unknown and unknowable. And through the gospel of Christ Crucified, God looks upon them with the same broken-hearted love that he had when he looked upon his son on the cross, and he says, "You're not nothing." Enough. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Now, there are a lot of people out there that we don't know. Strangers. People who are different than us, and maybe even people who make us afraid. But the gospel is true for them, whether we know them or not, whether we trust them or not, whether we like them or not. And as beloved children of God in Christ, we are all siblings. Inextricably linked by a circle that's never closed. And the gospel that is for all of us. There's no moment so low or so seemingly hopeless that God cannot call forth from it resurrection.